Welcome, class, and greetings to you all
to our course, Computer Organization and Architecture. I'll be taking you through this course together with the ones that we have, with the other one, Fundamentals of Information Systems. So you will realize some of the material that we are going to cover in this course also applies to some aspects we are covering in Fundamentals of Information Systems. So there might be a bit of repetition, just for emphasis sake, on things that we might have covered in Fundamentals of Information Systems. So our course outline is 5 main areas that we will look at. We'll try to reintroduce what a computer is to you. I know you've already done this in your first semester when you did the subject Computers, Drawing and Communication. Then we will look at the organization of the CPU. We'll talk about input and output organization, memory organization. Then we'll talk about parallel processing. So under the topic introduction to computers, we are going to cover the following areas as highlighted in this slide. Then, so let's look at the first area, which is the von Neumann architecture. I think most of us are familiar with this as the block diagram of a computer system. This represents the main components that make up or define a computer system. Now, in its simplest form, a computer system is made up of three parts, which are input, then the second block we have processes, or processing, then the third block we have our outputs. So this in its simplest form represents what a computer system, that is in its what abstract form. And I think most of us, we are familiar with the components that make up what these three main blocks. On input, we have what we call input devices. On processing, we have what we call the central processing unit. On outputs, we have what we call what? Output devices. So this is our course in abstract form. Computer organization and architecture. It will center around what these three blocks. So we can summarize the whole course in this diagram, where we'll talk about inputs, processing, and outputs. But you realize our course, computer organization and architecture, it will dwell around this box, the processing box. That's where we'll spend most of our time focusing on. But maybe just as a recap or a reminder, I want you to identify or list at least 5 input devices that you can think of or that you are familiar with from your previous course, that is the CDC. I will just list probably a few for you here. Input devices, we have the mouse, we have the touchpad, we have the keyboard, what other devices can you list? I won't give you all of them so that you can also exercise your mind. What other input devices do you know of that you have come across in your day-to-day use of the computer system? I've added a scanner there. When you are in a shop, these days there's that machine that they use at the till points to scan items, so that instead of the till operator punching the product or the item that you want to buy, it just passes that item in front of a scan. What is the name of that device? I will leave it for you to edit here. Then in terms of, we'll skip the processing box, we'll come back and talk about it. Let's look at the output box. What output devices can you talk about here? Let me list a few for you. One, printer, VDU, that is the visual display unit or the monitor. What other output device can you talk about? Let me put some question marks so that as you make your notes, you also add the various input devices. So as a person who uses computers or who is doing computer organization and architecture, we expect you to be familiar with the various hardware components that are attached or that operate with your computer. Remember, when you are doing this course, you are expected to have some troubleshooting skills, so that when you are using these devices or when you are attaching these devices to a computer, if a user faces challenges, you should be able to troubleshoot where the problem is. Because it's part of what? Of the computer system. You cannot be said to have done computer organization and architecture and you are not aware or you are not able to plug in these devices to your computer so that they are functional. I know when we're doing fundamentals of information systems, when we're looking at types of system software, we mentioned something about drivers. Maybe I should just highlight it here that these devices, these input and output devices that we are talking about, when they're attached to the computers, they need that system software called drivers for them to be able to communicate and function properly with what? With the computer system. So when you attach, say, a printer to your computer, it will first search for those drivers and install those drivers before you are able to print with that printer. Back in the days before the advent of the plug and play technology that comes in with most computing devices these days, where instead of you knowing which drivers to install or where to look for them, the computer now automatically looks for them and installs them for you. So you don't have to know which device drivers does my keyboard use for you to be able to use the keyboard. You just plug it. If your computer is connected to the internet, it automatically searches for the drivers. If it's a scanner, you just plug what? The scanner to the computer, and the computer will look for the drivers automatically from the internet and download them and installs them on the computer. But if you are not connected to the computer, I think if you want to test it or experiment, I want you to find probably a printer or a scanner and that you have never used on your laptop or your desktop. I want you to plug it onto what? Onto your PC. So when you install or attach that device without your computer being connected to the internet, I want you to test if you are able to print with that device or able to scan with that device. Then you will share with me the results. So let's just put it here as what? Some practical homework. IoT device installation. We want to test and see drivers in what in use or in operation, so that we get to see how that aspect of what of system software code drivers works or operate. Right, let's go and look at the central box, the processing box, and see what makes up what the central processing unit or the processing box. Remember, we said the computer system in abstract form is represented. This is the computer system. In fact, this is your whole course, computer organization and architecture. It's what is these three boxes. If you know and appreciate the functionalities of each box and how it relates to the next, then you are good to go for your exam. The central processing unit, sometimes, or it's commonly also referred to as the von Neumann architecture, that was first published in 1945 by von Neumann. And I think most computing devices use this what this layout to arrange their computing components. So the central processing unit, or CPU, or some refer to it as the processor, is made up of what of various components within it, which are the control unit, the ALU registers, then we have what the memory part. So the CPU is the brains behind the computer. It contains the circuitry that is responsible for executing all the instructions that what we give to the computer. That is, it will take the input from the input devices, convert it to a format that is understood by the other internal circuitries for processing, then passes out what the outputs to the output devices. So this is more like the brains of the computer system. If you are to look at it in layman's terms, I would say the diagram or the block diagram of a computer system, that is this von Neumann architecture we are talking about here, was inspired by the human design, where if you are to think of it in simpler terms, the input devices, these are your hands, your ears, your mouth, your leg, that exert or carry out various activities that are passed to the brain, which is the central processing unit, for processing. Then you get what? The results. Let's say if an input is put to your body, probably a pain input, your brain will process and react, then you probably what give out the relevant output. It might be a scream or an action that reveals that you've what received some pain to your body. So you look at the diagram of the central processing unit, you realize probably this was inspired from the design of the human body. You look at other input device, the mouth. It takes food as input, then it is sent to the what? To the stomach for processing, and it is converted what to the relevant nutrients that what the body needs. Then it is again what given out as outputs. One, you realize your brain will record that your stomach is what is full. Then the relevant waste is passed out what through the relevant processes. So you realize the diagram of the computer system
if you are to think of it in that simpler form, it's not that very complicated to look at. You are looking at the central processing unit as the brains of the human being. Now, the central processing unit is the brains of what of the computer system. So we say that the central processing unit is various components or various parts that make it. And these various parts are responsible for performing specific activities within what? The computing environment. We have the control unit. This is what controls the operations of all devices that are attached what? To the computer. Telling them what to do when instruction is given, which instruction gets priority, which instruction is put on hold, which input device gets priority, which input device is put on hold. So it controls what the operations of the computer system. That is from fetching instruction to decoding instructions to executing them. These are all controlled by what? By the central processing unit. We might need to talk about the fetch, decode, execute cycle so that we appreciate and understand how instructions are created, fetched, executed, and the output given what in a computer system. I think you remind me so that we might talk about this at a later stage. Then we look at the arithmetic and logic unit, the ALU. Basically, this is the mathematical hub of the computer system. In simpler terms, we might say this is the calculator of the computer system, because all computations or all calculations and logic operations are carried out in the arithmetic and logic unit. So you might think it, or for it to be easy to remember, just think it as the calculator for the computer system. I know most of you do not like mathematics for one reason or the other. I know you are facing challenges in maths one, maths two. So probably it's got something to do with your ALU unit not being very, very efficient in what in executing mathematical operations. So the part of your brain also has a function that is responsible for performing mathematical and logical operations. Whatever data processing is being carried out in a computer system, the data needs to be stored somewhere where it can be accessed quickly for additional operations to be performed. So for this to be possible, we have what we call registers, which are high-speed storage areas where data is stored what before and during processing. So we have various types of registers. One with memory address registers, then memory data registers, accumulator, program counter, and carry instruction registers. I think if you look at the names of these registers, they are more or less self-explanatory. Memory address register, this stores the location of the data that needs to be addressed. So when data is being fetched into, or when data is stored in a computer system, it is stored at a particular location. That location is an address or a reference point. Let's just use the word address. Just like we have our house numbers where we are stored, if we are data. So for me to access where James is, the memory address location for James, if James has data, it will be 1472 Cherrytombo Close, Maronera. That's where that data called John or memory is what lives. So the memory address registers, they store the exact location where data is stored. So the same thing goes in computers. Data is stored in what, in particular addresses. When you look at the hard drive of a computer system, it has got sectors and cylinders. And these sectors and cylinders, they have specific addresses. So it is at these specific addresses that data is what is written to and stored. Then memory address data register was data that is being transferred to and from memory. So you realize these registers, they enable processing of the CPU to be fast. If the CPU was going to be using the secondary storage location, that is the hard drive, to store data for processing, you realize the processing of the computer system would have been very, very slow, because it takes a lot of time to transfer data to and from the hard drive. So that would have been very efficient for processing purposes. We want to store data in the hard drive that has been what already processed and stored. So this is the purpose of what? Of registers. Then memory. So we have looked at the control unit, the arithmetic and logic unit, and the registers. Now the other item that we are going to look at is what? Is the computer memory. Now, when we are talking about memory in reference to the CPU, we are mainly interested in the RAM, or sometimes referred to as the primary memory. The reason why this is important to the central processing unit or the operations of the computer in general, you realize a computer with more RAM or a computing device with more RAM performs faster than a computer with less RAM. For example, I know most of you have computers that have 2 gig RAM. I just want you to compare the performance or the speed of your computer in executing instructions with a friend's device or a friend's computer that has 4 gig RAM. Or if you have a mobile phone, I want you to check the amount of RAM that your mobile phone has. You realize some have 2 gig RAM, some have 1 gig RAM, others have 256 MB, depending on what, on the mobile device you have. But you realize a computing device with more RAM performs faster than a computing device with less RAM. And the other issue that you should consider as a computing person when buying computing devices, or be it mobile device, remember when we're talking about application software, operating systems and stuff like that, in fundamentals of information system, those softwares have minimum installation requirements in terms of RAM and processing power. For example, the minimum installation requirement in terms of RAM for Windows 7, it should be about 2 gig RAM. Now, if you are going to install Windows 7 or Windows 10, that states that it has a minimum installation requirement of 2 gig RAM. If you install it on a device with exactly 2 gig RAM or less, what do you think will be the result in terms of performance? Chances are that operating system will perform very slowly, to the extent that you think probably the operating system is a problem. So as a computer technician or a network administrator, as you are buying and installing these softwares, you should also know the processor power or the type of processor your computer has, the amount of memory the computer has. So you realize in terms of processors, I know some of you are using laptops with Core i3s, Core i5, Core i7. You need to know the kind of processor that you have on your computer. in the amount of RAM that is there. The faster your processor, the better you are. The more RAM you have, the better you are. So RAM is responsible for keeping data temporarily during processing. We would refer it as the volatile memory, because it only keeps the contents that are being processed as long as there is power. If you lose power, the contents of RAM are also lost. So when we classify memory, computer memory, we usually classify it in as volatile or non-volatile memory. Volatile memory being memory that loses its contents when the computer loses power. Non-volatile memory is not affected by the loss of power. So volatile memory, we are talking about RAM. Non-volatile memory, we're talking about the hard disk drive, the USB, that is the secondary storage locations. Now we go on to look at buses. I usually give it or say it as an example that buses, these are the more of the transmission channels. I remember in the previous class I was saying these are the supports that carry data from one point to the other in the computing system. If you look at a motherboard of a PC, you realize there, or even the motherboard of your mobile device, or any motherboard that you can come across, you realize there are some very thin lines that are there on the motherboard. Those are the buses that we are talking about that moves instructions from one point to the other, or electrical power or electrical signals from one point to the other. Remember, these words that we are saying or that we are typing, when they are put into the motherboard, they will be moving is what is electrical signals, that is ones and zeros. So we have various types of buses in our computer systems that carry data from one point to the other. If we are going to come back to this slide, you realize we might have a bus specifically for carrying address-related instructions. Then we have a bus for carrying data. So there are various types of buses that are there. We have the data bus, the instruction bus, the control bus. I want you to go and make notes on buses that are available in what in the PC. So probably another area that I want you to go and look at is make additional notes on buses. On the, let's say, just five types of that are there in what in the central processing unit. So you name the bus that is there and the work that it what it does. So in short, this is the layout of the computer system or the block diagram of the computer system that you are supposed to know. Knowing how this works enables you to even be able to troubleshoot the various challenges that we have. So we said our syllabus requires us to look at the von Neumann architecture. There's another architecture that is out there called the Harvard architecture. I know our syllabus doesn't look at that, but for interest's sake, and also just to open up our eyes, I want you to go and look at the Harvard architecture. You compare it with the von Neumann architecture. Then you make some minor notes just to note the major difference or the major advantages of each type of what architecture. So if you have questions, I want you to post them in the comment section below this video on YouTube, or you post your questions and comments on the discussion forum on the Impact platform. So I know very much that data is expensive these days. So I will not make these videos very long. At most, I will try to, if it's long, the longest I want to go on these videos is 30 minutes, so that at least the data costs are manageable for you, so that you'll be able to view what these videos. Thank you very much. I'll be posting the next video on our next topic very soon.